As we've seen all morning, data revolves around largely two conversations, player data and user and fan data. In the first of our two sessions before lunch, noted for all of you all, our guests will talk about player and performance data. Who really owns it? As we've seen since morning, there are two schools of thought. Some believe that the teams and federations in whose employment these players are own this data, while others believe the player whose data it actually is actually owns it. And then what is to be said about players or sports people who play individual sports? To discuss this, I would like to invite on stage Mr. Anish Dayal, advocate of the Supreme Court of India, Dr. Payoshni Mitra, athletes' rights activist, Ms. Tanvie Hans, professional footballer, ex-Tottenham Hotspur Ladies FC, Fulham Ladies FC, and head football coach at Cult.fit, Dr. Digpal Ranawat, performance director at the Abhinav Bindra Training Targeting Performance Center, and Mr. Agnidipto Tarafder, assistant professor of law at the West Bengal National University of Juridical Sciences, it's the T, I tell you, who will moderate this panel for us.
We have a panel where there are people who work on the science of how to gather data, how to assess player performance, etc. We have people who have worked as activists on issues and cases, especially very important cases, where the misinterpretation or misanalysis of data was the key contention. We've had we have a Supreme Court advocate amongst us who's worked on doping cases, etc., to a large extent. And of course, we have a professional footballer and football coach. So we've got essentially all the perspectives we need, I'd say, on to have a panel on data and the use of player data. Now, it's expected that the moderator will give an important, interesting initial sermon, but I will not. Because the expertise that you see in front of you is the one that should be allowed to speak. I'll only tell you this, what are the rules of the game? We start with an opening statement. Everybody talks about their, a couple of minutes each, talks about the stress areas, after which we revert to the question answer session moderated by me, which is essentially why I'm here. And after that, I'd like to open it for the audience, if that's all right. It's a 45-minute session. We don't have a lot of time. So I'll skip the large intro and tell you only this, that since morning, you've heard perspectives from Dr. Sengupta, from Mr. Chaudhary and others. You've heard perspectives about how beneficial it could be to have a framework protecting data, how important it is for this data to be harnessed properly. We have amongst us here people who harness that data. But questions that a number of us don't know about, because we're on the law side of things, we don't sometimes realize that there are very significant legal questions which are raised when this harnessing process takes place. How you are extracting the data, for one. Second, whose consent are you seeking? The question that was already mentioned, the issue of who owns the data. But even beyond data ownership, the use, the secondary use, etc. of data, all of these become key aspects that require talking about. Third, and I think this is a very interesting point on the panel, that there are several ways of carrying out this collection process. A lot of us, even if we're not players and not into athletics as such, have started using Fitbits. To what extent does this have an impact on the kind of data that is being generated and the kind of data that's being transmitted? That is one aspect of it. The second, and this is also, I think, a very interesting aspect, is that when we talk about data, we talk about some people having less privacy than others. We talk about, in an almost like an Orwellian statement, we talk about how celebrities have lesser rights to privacy than you and I, the common citizen. Does that apply equally to players as well? These are contentious issues that we must deal with. And therefore, without further ado, let me hand it over to the experts. If from left to right, Mr. Dayal, you would start. Yeah.
Thank you for the introductions, and great to be on the panel. As you can see, my favorite sports jersey is Go Sports. I feel part of the family, so it's good to be back here. And one big takeaway as an opening remark from today's morning sessions, starting from Dr. Sengupta is that I think I need to become a data protection lawyer now. I think it's the time to evolve and possibly earn more money on there. But clearly, data is obviously what we need to look at for the future as practitioners. One statement in the Puttaswamy judgment of the Supreme Court struck me, and it stood out, where it was quoted as saying that we are increasingly becoming our quantified selves. I think we experience that in everyday life. We are constantly transacting online. Data is going back and forth. Now, the challenge, of course, which has been highlighted over the morning, is there. One point I want to make as a practitioner who's been advising on contracts for many couple of decades now is that data protection has not crept into contractual protection, at least so far. We are not seeing data protection regimes into contracts as of now. What is so far being done in contracts is the traditional confidentiality clauses, where a player will say that a player contracting with his or her league will effectively be told that we will be taking your image rights, which classically fall under the intellectual property silo, or you will have to declare, as they do in the IPL contracts, for sake of anti-corruption, that you have to declare your emails, your phone numbers, your SIM cards 3 months prior to the league and 3 months post, I mean, if I remember rightly, and that data will be used and kept confidential. That also relates to medical history, which is also a point which was discussed. So we have not really evolved our contractual regime to cover aspects of data protection in India, primarily because we don't have a full-fledged statute, and we hope that we'll have it in the next 6 months. Currently, there's only the sensitive data regulation under the IT Act, which is there, which is sort of a small baby in front of the big data protection challenges that we have. So not having a regulator, not having a full regime, nobody, at least in this country, is ready to even negotiate, accept, or succumb to data protection clauses. That's the reality. So maybe a lot of this discussion is way ahead of what is there in practice, is what the point I wanted to make. We need to see it also from the point that negotiations in contractual areas between the player or the practicality of negotiations is very often very far from theory. People do sign on dotted lines all the time. We advise leagues, we advise franchises, and believe me, just to give you a picture, it doesn't work ideally in the way that we analyze it here theoretically. So we must marry that theory to practice somewhere if we need to find solutions. And just want to pass that.
I am Payoshni Mitra. I have no expertise whatsoever as far as data, player and performance data is concerned, and I was wondering why I am here. What I can talk about in connection to data, as much as I understand it, is from my experience of working with high testosterone athletes in the past one decade. There is one particular thing that comes to my mind as far as data is concerned. Now, when we are talking about high T athletes, we tend to talk about their progression. A lot of times, what triggers an investigation, a medical investigation, is the fact that they have these data of progression. So one doing very well, very quickly, often triggers investigation as far as performance is concerned. As far as the player data is concerned, obviously we can talk about athlete biological passport later, where a lot of data is already available to the Federation. Now, how is the Federation going to use this data? that they receive as part of these, the athletics biological passport is interesting. A lot of times, as you just mentioned, that players are signing in dotted lines without even reading what is there. There are consent forms that I have myself seen in case of Ms. Chand, where there was just a one-liner and a signature, and it was considered a consent to an investigation. In India, we are dealing with federations where investigations are done secretly without any documents, any paperwork whatsoever. But this information from such investigation are then passed on to some other authorities or some other group. So it's very important to talk about data collection, informed consent, and also the notion of confidentiality in the context of data. And I don't know if I should say, really talk about confidentiality here, but one thing I have been increasingly thinking about is this whole protocol of confidentiality that is talked about by, for example, the International Association for Athletics Federations in the context of the work that I do. And I feel the confidentiality protocol is often there to protect them and to sort of protect them from being identified as an organization which are conducting tests, not only investigation, but also intervention, very invasive, irreversible in medical intervention. And they can protect themselves through this confidentiality clause. All these things come, there is this data which they have access to. There is this information about medical intervention that they have access to and no one else knows about. And the athlete has never been educated about how to deal with all these things. So these are things that I come across while I work, which is not necessarily always to do with player and performance data, but yes, also to do with them. I hope it is useful, and I will go on to answer your questions, Agnidipto, when you have one.
Hi, everyone. I'm Tanvie Hans, and I'm a footballer. Much like she said, I don't have a lot of technical know-how on the collection, the collection of data, the process and things, but I will try and contribute to this panel from the point of view of a player and what I feel the importance of having data as an athlete is, and how I see it even from a manager's point of view or a coach's point of view. I do imagine that once I do retire from playing, I would want to get into the managerial side of things. And I see the importance that data collection does have of course, individual athletes. Before I went and I gave my trials in London as well, it was extremely important for me to make sure I was improving. And the best way to do that is to quantify my improvement. And we did that obviously through, various methods. And I do see the importance. I, as an athlete, think it is important to quantify. That is the most obvious way of seeing an improvement. But I do feel at the end of the day, sport is also an art. And I don't, like you said, we're quantified versions, quantified selves of our, sorry, say that again? We're quantified selves, which I think is obviously in sport, if we just end up quantifying everything and sort of make future decisions based on quantities and things, I do think that it is very limiting. I give one basic example. There's always that that controversy of who's the best player in the world. I'm a big fan of Messi. I really, really respect Ronaldo as well. If Messi, now everyone who has followed his career knows that he had a growth hormone deficiency when he was young. If at that point someone had taken his blood sample and said, based on your current genetics or whatever, you don't have a future in the sport. If that was the case and then Barcelona didn't sign him up, based on just that fact, we wouldn't have had a Messi today to celebrate. So I do think that quantifying it purely and saying that football is just, it should just be done through technology and we can make future decisions based on it. 100% 100% think that it does help in making some intelligent decisions, maybe predicting performances of the future to some extent, but I don't want to take away from the fact that it is an art, and we should leave some room for that as well. Yeah.
Hello. So I represent Abhinav Bindra targeting performance centers across India, and we have a pure data-driven approach. And I like to highlight few areas where, you know, when an athlete comes in, we have assessments based on data, which helps us form the starting point. So a sport-specific assessment has been conducted where different variables specific to the sport, like stability, mobility, posture, strength, everything has been quantified on very high-grade medical device, medical-grade devices, which can actually help us have a precise standard of validity and reliability of that data. And post which, it's just not the assessment, the data has been used to make a customized training protocol for each athlete. So when we don't have a data-driven approach, if there are 12 athletes and we do an assessment which is more subjective in nature, and then we implement same program for them, which is not justified because every athlete is different. They have different deficits. They have different areas of improvement. We can only highlight when we have data to precisely quantify that. When it comes to training, we have devices where we get real-time data when the athlete is training. For example, I'll give you a very basic example. If an athlete needs to do a squat, you know, he generally will be doing squats in the gym where there's a mirror and, you know, he does hundreds of squats. But he is relied on the feedback which he gets from the support staff around him, which is limited. Because when you do a squat, I want to understand as a sports scientist that, you know, how much weight he's putting on either side, the impact of that weight bearing on his joints, the range of motion real time. And that's powerful data. And that helps me make sure that the quality is maintained over quantity. Same thing applies to our training and treatment and recovery protocols as well. For example, if a therapist needs to do myofascial release, mobilization, manipulation for the athlete who comes in for a treatment or recovery, we have a sensorized bed where the athlete lies down and there's a screen on which real-time data or the pressure or the tension profile of the athlete has been highlighted. The therapist is empowered to precisely apply the right amount of pressure, do the right amount of thrust to have a desirable outcome of that treatment session for that athlete.
Oh, thank you. That was a little abrupt, but thank you for a lot of these very interesting and crucial inputs. Since we spoke in this order, I'll ask the questions in the opposite. So first, to Dr. Ranawat, my question would be sort of taking from what Tanvie said. When you're using technology to identify budding talent, what happens when you face a situation like a Messi? When you've got an athlete who's come to you who does not look fully developed physically, etc., under such circumstances, how does predictive analysis come into the picture to tell you the story that this athlete's life might, you know, end up being?
So you see, predicting or coming, drawing certain conclusion from testing is just one parameter which can be looked at, but it cannot be defined as the conclusive parameter to say that the athlete is good or bad. There are a lot of different variables which impact the athlete's performance and his career over the time period, his psychological well-being, his, you know, the environment where he's training or the training load he's exposed to. So, you know, it's just not one factor.
Just as a quick follow-up, what is the consent framework that is followed in such cases? Like when an athlete comes in to train with your academy and you're helping this person out, because we spoke so much about the ownership of data, where does this data, does it get stored with you? Does it get transmitted to secondary bodies which may be affiliated to you? Or is it reverted back to the player? Do you keep a copy, etc.? These are the...
So it's a very important point which you have put across. And when the athlete comes to our center, there is a consent form where the therapist or the doctor will sit down with the athlete, explain him every point, what assessment he will go through, because, you know, the assessments are based on the particular sport the athlete is in. And then the importance of the data collected, what we are trying to distinguish, what would be the outcome, how that data will help the athlete and help us derive or define the right training protocol for him. Once the athlete signs the consent and is aware of the whole protocol, we make sure when the athlete is on the machines, the same protocols have been repeated to emphasize if the athlete has any doubts in between, he can ask us. And, you know, if the athlete is not willing to sign, it's his choice. You know, he can say no anytime that he doesn't want to go through performance testing. And another important point which I like to highlight is, we have scenarios where the coach asks for the data. For us, it's just not a process, but it's mandatory where the athlete has to give a written consent saying that he is aware of the data assessment, what has been conducted, and he is willing, you know, he vouched that the data can be forwarded to the ex-coach and for this purpose. And one more case, if an athlete is a minor, it's the parent who needs to be there with the athlete. We explain the parent the whole procedure, what would be conducted for the athlete in this whole performance assessment, and we carry it forward.
This is what I mean when I say an expert. He's preempting questions I'm about to ask. So I was going to ask him about the consent on minors, but he's already got that. Okay. Tanvie, the question I had, ma'am, you wanted to pitch in. Yeah, absolutely.
So I was wondering, in cases when athletes' parents are not so involved, in some sports we don't have, you know, young people where their parents are as involved as probably in certain sports. And then who, if the athlete is young, who is signing?
So it would be the guardian or, you know, the person, maybe if someone comes in from the sports department, if they don't have their parents, so someone from the sports department or the coach who is responsible for the training says that, you know, these are the assessment we go through and we sign for the assessment, and we make sure that we explain the athlete as well in that whole process.
So do you think, what I'm trying to understand here is the person who's signing, in case of an athlete who's young, has the best intention, you know, for the athlete. So how do you ensure that if it's a person from the sports department or the coach signing that?
So for us, you know, it's a situation where the assessment what we are doing, it's only for the benefit of the athlete. So that data cannot be misused, because the data has been stored with us and it's only been released or it's only been shared when the person who has signed the consent form or the athlete has, you know, again, given us the permission to do so.
Okay. Tanvie, the question I had for you was... the question I had for you is that, could you maybe share some of your experiences of having trained with equipment where you know for a fact, you have prior knowledge of the fact that you are being tested. So certain, say for example, if at an academy of the sort, you're being tested and your performance is being recorded. Does that have is there a mental aspect to that? Are you more aware and as a result, perhaps more conscious, say when you're on the pitch? Because there are several levels of testing. One is you put wires, the way laymen look at it, you put wires all over your body and you test for muscle power, etc., etc. The other is the observational data that you pick up when the game is on. Does this add to the pressure that is already there to perform?
Okay, so I've had very limited experience with technology because I think the women's game is still growing and this is a new inclusion and all of it. But the experience that I do have, based on that, and if I put myself in the shoes of someone who is probably being tested, I think for me personally, the few times that I have used technology to sort of demarcate my progress, I think it's been extremely handy for me as well, personally, for my own progress. I do also understand it from a coach's and management's point of view. When you are representing a team, when you are representing a team that is representing a club or a state or a country, there are a lot of stakeholders involved, a lot of people's interests involved. Of course, you need to be performing at your best. I see the importance of technology there and to make sure that you are giving your best, and we have selected the best players for the team. Personally, if you know, the vest that we wear for heat mapping and for all that, if I was told that I have to wear this and I'm wearing it throughout the training and stuff, It does make you conscious, of course it does. But I also feel that, this is again a very personal thing, but when I play, I also get extremely involved in the game and I forget the attire I have on, you know? But obviously the moments that I do recall that I do have this on, it does keep you obviously a little conscious and a little on your toes, which is a good thing. You know, you are pushing yourself at your maximum and they obviously want the results at your maximum. So I do think for me, it's not as intrusive. It doesn't play on my mind too much. If it does, it's a good thing. It works in my favor. And it makes me probably play the best I possibly can.
Fair enough.
I'd like to add to this. So you see, when we talk about data-driven approach with the elite athletes, or with an athlete who has been training for 10, 15 years, you know, he's used to a set pattern of training. And if you incorporate data which he has not, you know, used, or, you know, certain form of technology, it becomes, you know, there's a lot of barrier from their end. They don't want to change their approach, what they have been, you know, used to for a certain time period. So that's why it's very important if the data-driven approach can be taken to the grassroots, where from the starting point itself, they are aware of those basic assessments, the importance of, you know, incorporating measurements into their training, and you know, it will help us evolve over the time period to have excellence and reduce the number of injuries over the time.
Sorry, can I just add to that? He's right in saying that. I do feel that after a certain point in time, I remember before I went to London for the trials, obviously we used to take measurements of my sprinting speed and stuff, and I, you know, with the hope that I'll improve. And one of the things that my coach had picked up on, he took a video of me sprinting and he told me that my hand action needs to improve. And for me, I was still fast regardless of the hand action because that's the way I've naturally been, like, learned to run. But there is a video on YouTube, if you've ever seen it, where they have compared Ronaldo's sprinting style to an athlete's sprinting style. And it's completely different because obviously the kind of motions you have to do are different. Based on the fact that I have pretty much always been a footballer since I was small, I was never taught as an athlete. I was taught more into sports and, you know, movements that have a lot of agility, change of direction and stuff. Based on that, my hand action was obviously not perfect. Okay, it wasn't very streamlined. And then my coach tried to change my hand action a lot through that. And I just couldn't do it because for me, what was natural. And I was still clocking a good time. So I did, you know, so that became, it did become a bit of a conversation I had to have with my coach. But then, yeah, I mean, that's from personal experience as well.
So that's a perspective that tells you that data doesn't necessarily have to be intrusive, or even if it is intrusive, it could be used for the positive. Now, to Dr. Mitra, my question is sort of along the same lines. You've worked on cases, some of which scholars have called the most, you know, obvious acts of sex discrimination in sport. You have dealt also with an internationally reputed athlete who has several times complained of depression because of the kind of testing and the intrusion that has taken place in her life. Could you share with us some experiences about, you know, the mental aspect of say, mandatory testing with, and the impact it has on the people's, you know, players' mental health?
So earlier what I was talking about was data collection process, which I find very disturbing in most cases. A lot of cases that I have come across where investigation has taken place and athletes have not been informed prior to the investigation exactly what the investigation was about. So often told that it's some kind of a doping you know, test. Or something to do with high performance sport, just quoting, you know, some of the athletes, how they have explained what the test was about. And then they undergo such tests and then they are told, okay, this means that you can't compete or whatever. You know, there are athletes who have come to know about a particular variation that they have at the time when they have been tested. And it's been quite, you know, it's a huge and it's a big information for them. And obviously nothing much has been explained to them afterwards. What happens is when we talk about data, we tend to have data about athletes who are active, athletes who are running, athletes, we have data of these athletes until they are running. We don't have any information when they stop running. Our interest, not my interest really, but the Federation's interest lies with the athletes who are currently running or who once used to run and their data. Once these athletes stop running, because of, you know, as investigation or after medical intervention, hardly any of them who have underwent surgery in the past few years have been able to compete at the same level. Almost all of them, according, have disappeared. So we don't have any data. So there is that, void. And we are not thinking about that. What we are focusing on is who's making it to the podium, because we have lots of data around those athletes. We don't know about the mental health situation of most of these athletes who have disappeared, because we don't have any information. And the federations who have actively taken part in investigating them and then providing them with medical intervention of some kind have never taken initiative to find out what has happened to these athletes who have disappeared. So we have very little information about mental health issues of those athletes. The ones that I have worked with have been through, you know, terrible phases. They tried to physically harm themselves. They tried to commit suicide. There's one athlete in India who committed suicide a long time back. There is an example of alcoholism and other kinds of substance abuse, depression, no support whatsoever from the Federation or the sporting fraternity once they stop participating.
I was also extremely excited about the fact that I get to have at least one lawyer on the panel, because all my legal queries need to be directed somewhere, right? So now that Mr. Dayal is here,
shoot.
Taking off from what Dr. Mitra said, especially with the doping cases, we've had one day before yesterday that's come out in the news.
I'm his lawyer.
I didn't know that. Okay. I had a bona fide question.
Thanks to references.
Okay. So the question that I wanted to ask you, especially because it came up so recently, is about the level of awareness even amongst the, you know, sports, like even in cricket, which is essentially the sport. While, let's say, we were growing up, we didn't have access to so much. So these people, despite having the enormous amount of publicity, money, etc., that goes into their sport, as opposed to many several other sports, at least in India, despite that, the level of awareness seems pretty abysmal. Would you say that, you know, that should be an area we should definitely focus on? Because a lot of it happens out of, let's say, lack of knowledge rather than design.
Okay, so you're speaking my language. I have from on various forums, including arguing cases before NADA, panels, in articles in the paper, and in various workshops which Go Sports has conducted with Paralympic athletes and particular targeted workshops. I think the team knows here had made a very, very strong case for awareness. I translate it into saying, and which I've again written about, is that I have a strong believer in restorative justice than absolutely retributive justice. I think there is a case, particularly in our country, which has a very varying socio-economic demography. We have athletes, when we're talking of athletes, you have a certain sort of set probably in mind. The elite English-speaking athlete is not the reality. When we deal with athletes coming on doping issues, they are people who cannot speak English or Hindi, and possibly also not Tamil, and they are coming from villages, and they have succeeded in sport. We had done the relay rails girls case, where four girls, Ashwinya Kunji and others, but could not speak the same language, but they ran well, they understood the language of relay. Now, so that's a reality. How do you trickle awareness to this very wide demographic is the question. That means, number one, we got to work a lot harder, right? We simply can't have workshops. NADA has said this often, and we're going into the anti-doping regime. I don't want to go there because I'll take another hour. But even any other sporting organization, particularly federations, what Dr. Mitra said, have just a hands-off approach. Who is doing awareness? Who is doing awareness in the right format? Is the athlete being told in his or her language that he or she understands what is this whole regime about? Be it anti-doping, be it sex determination, be it data collection. So therefore, if that is established, that we are not doing enough there, then it drives a huge dent into what is legally called informed consent. GDPR also speaks about that consent has to be invited in the clearest form. Now, let me give you an example from a different industry, which is called clinical research. I have had the fortune of sitting on some ethics committees of hospitals, and we are looking at the process which is followed for clinical research. In the earlier years, when the clinical research industry started in this country, because of regulations, opening up of regulations, the consent forms which were available for patients which were willing to give everything just to save their lives and on an experimental drug were all drafted possibly in the West in English, which in multiple pages, giving various qualifications, which even I as an experienced lawyer would take about half an hour to understand. As ethics committees, we try to tell them that, listen, please put this in Hindi, Punjabi, put it in one page. Is there a clause saying that has somebody read it out to the person before taking consent? Now, in that industry, we successfully moved it. I was thrown out of the ethics committee because of this approach, I must inform you, after 3 years, and of a fairly prominent leading chain of the hospitals in this country, only because I was drawing a wedge in to what was simply protocols being handed over by doctors by saying, like, let's do this, I don't care. Something's being drafted in America, so what? So I'm giving you a reality of another industry which fortunately moved in the last 10 years to places where now I happily see Hindi and Punjabi consent forms. So for this industry, when we are at the anvil of discussing data and consent, I think this is a very important point to have in mind, because then you will have real informed consent.
Absolutely. And we'll go the other way this time. And starting with Ms. Dayal again, the question that I have as a follow-up to what you just answered would be, then we have to then reimagine the consent framework. In a country with as little digital literacy as we have, and as you very correctly pointed out, the reality of sport in India is not an elite English-speaking crowd, but it's essentially from the villages. So Haryana has won probably more medals for us in the last couple of years than several other states combined in the last 10. So considering these realities, it is important for us to rethink the consent framework. We can't think of it in terms of, okay, you've signed a certain piece of paper, and because the law presumes that, you know, not ignorance of law is not an excuse, but ignorance of law is often the reality, even for those who have signed. So one aspect of my question is, how do we rethink the consent framework? Can we just say that it's enough to, you know, give them handouts in a local language that they can read or get it read out to them? Because sometimes when I say that, okay, I will not transmit your data to X person, and this is written in a vernacular, despite that it might not make sense to somebody who doesn't understand the implication of sending data across. Aadhaar is a reality in this country. People are signing up for it. People are signing up for it because we don't understand the value of data. So in that sense, would you say that there's a need to relook at the way we conceptualize consent?
Yes, certainly. I think it has to be completely understood and reworked. I'll give you an example from, the doping side. Now, there are penalties given because athletes sign on the doping control form when the sample is taken, because it's a standard form. My anecdotal evidence, which I get from when I interrogate athletes who come to us for help, is to say that, did the doping control officer tell you something? Did you tell them something which you are telling me now? He said, saab bataya tha, sorry, whoever doesn't understand anything, but anyway. I told them, but he said, just sign. I was in competition, I had just won at a podium, I just went there, they took my sample, I took my trousers down and took the sample. I mean, there are circumstances. Now, there is a very clear framework of law for everything.
clear framework for doping, the clear framework for data protection, but that's what I said in my opening remark, practicality. Then what we have now started telling athletes, if you have a doubt in the after you sign the doping control form, if you have a doubt or an issue which you have in mind or a caveat which you have in mind, annotate the doping control form in whichever language you know. It's a desperate measure because that is my evidence when I defend you to say that you had something in mind, which was a qualified consent, not a full consent. Or if you have the capability to reach out to a lawyer or something, write an email next day. That is where technology is coming in useful for consent. Now you use things because most of the young athletes and all are good with mobiles and at least sending out even one-liners in English, right? Literally one-liners in English and some broken English saying, I agree, I do not agree. Even at least that they can manage. So my advice as a lawyer is, please, if it's a qualified consent, please communicate on the best, easiest possible thing is email the federation, email to somebody, because that is forensic evidence for me later to say that you had that in mind at that particular point of time. That's forensic evidence for me as a lawyer. I can use it. But if you don't do anything and tell me 2 months later after you get some kind of sanction that or an offense that you did this, how do I prove? So you're absolutely right. I think it's critical for us to consider technology, use of technology, and use of and language.
Correct.
Yeah, vernacular has to certainly come in.
Absolutely.
I don't understand all of media today. The successful business and media is all looking at vernacular. English media doesn't do well. We know the numbers. Probably Tamil media or Kannada media does better. I don't see why we are not looking at the vernacular.
Absolutely. Dr. Mitra, again, taking off from that same issue of players understanding and not understanding consent, you have been very vocal about the surreptitious testing that will be done despite the battles that have already been won. You're pretty certain that national federations will continue to test, national federations will continue to ensure that they don't face international embarrassment because of players. What is the exact concern, if you could just, you know, highlight it for the audience?
So the current DST regulations, yeah, which are in practice in connection, correct, to that, right? So there it kind of says that the International Association for Athletics Federation will conduct investigation and not the national federations. But national, I don't see how the national federation is not going to get involved, because they are talking about allowing all athletes to compete at the national level, but they are going to investigate once they compete at the international level. The national federations are bound to intervene here. If we look at one of these
but
examples,
not legally, you're saying?
Not
obviously, because they don't
clear,
have the...
It's not clear in the DST regulations. At some point they say that they're, you know, they don't need to be involved, but at some point they do put the onus on the athlete or the national federations as well. One example I would like to give you is of Kenya. Before the World Relay Games in May, recently in Japan, Kenya dropped a couple of athletes and it was in the news, right? And they dropped these athletes before the game's last minute. One of the athletes was vocally talking to the media about it. Now that, the way it happened, and if you dig further, you would know that that was a clear case where National Federation got involved in spite of whatever the DST regulations are saying. Now, I don't know how far this is connected to this particular panel, but what is important here is to understand that the international federations are providing these regulations, but they are not really educating the national federations. And the national federations somehow feel bound by these regulations. And that is what I was told by the Athletics Federation of India when Ms. Chand was banned in 2014, that we are bound by the IAF regulations. Not that they know much about the regulations, but they're bound by it. The regulations which was attached to the letter that banned Duti was a different regulation. It wasn't the hyperandrogenism regulations, it was the transgender regulations which was attached with the letter. So they had no clue what they were up to. And I keep trying to draw the line between hyperandrogenism and the current DST regulations and the transgender regulations. Even today in the morning, in the first presentation by Dr. Shengupto, I felt that, you know, it was not clearly mentioned that Paula Radcliffe was talking about transgender athletes in the video, and Castor is definitely not a transgender athlete. She's a woman who was born a woman, who was brought up as a woman, reared up as a woman, identified all her life as a woman, and she shouldn't be called a transgender athlete. And I try and draw that line very clearly. So obviously, you know, I'm not sure if I answered your question, but...
So the apprehensions are real.
Yeah.
The apprehensions are real. Right. To Tanvi, my question is slightly different. Sort of connected to this, but do you think that somewhat this problem may be solved if instead of federations and regulatory bodies, more control over personal data was handed over to the players? Because again, there's a case to be made where a sports person is a celebrity, and a celebrity has a lesser right of privacy. So you have to have greater, stricter measures to ensure fairness in sport, etc., which is obviously comes from doping, etc. All of these concerns are there, which are not there for a private citizen. As a result, certain regulations are made. Do you think that a greater amount of control over personal data, if given to players, might be able to remedy this situation?
I think so. I do feel that for sure. Obviously, any data that, for instance, I've been subject to, that I've sort of had to go through any sort of technology or whatever, I've had access to it. And it's true, I do come from a privileged, you know, background. I understand English. I would probably read anything I signed thoroughly. Yep. You know, I'd probably have a second person also, second opinion and things like that. But I play this country where there are several languages within one team. We have communication problems on the field, forget about off the field, you know. So, of course, I can understand if I had a Manipuri player with me, and we're both signing the, you know, a form together. It would be important for me to make sure she has as much knowledge of what she's signing and she understands the implications, because I can read it, I can understand it, I'll be satisfied, I'll sign it. She will get some vague idea of what she's doing, but she may not. And I can understand that the fact that there's lack of clarity in what she's signing, that can be daunting. And that can sort of suddenly feel intrusive, and, you know, it could mean anything in the future. And I do think that it is very empowering to have complete information about it. And yes, if she knows that she has access to the data that she's giving out, I'm sure it will also, you know, make her feel a lot more comfortable. And it definitely should be one of the clauses. Always, I think, as far as data, you know, personal data. I've personally been more in interaction with observational data, you know, the team formations, all that stuff, which is not very intrusive. Mm-hmm. But I do see how it can be. And I, for someone who can understand also, would find it intrusive. Yeah. Of course, someone who's not understanding the language, you know, of exactly what they're signing, I can see how scary that would be. And absolutely, they should have complete understanding, complete control over what they're giving out, and understand the implications more than anything else. Yeah.
Right. To Dr. Ranawat, the last question for the session, because we're ending here. So a futuristic question. What is the status of predictive analysis in sport? And where do you see it going in, let's say, the next, say, a decade or so? Will we be able to, you know, pinpoint a situation where you know that a player with a certain physical condition will be able to, let's say, last in the sport for X number of years, is likely to face Y kind of injuries, and, you know, perhaps have Z kind of disease post-retirement, or when the retirement could possibly be? Because these will have important these will be important issues in negotiating with, let's say, the sporting brands that they have become part of, teams they become part of. So where are we standing? Where is that technology right now?
So you see, data is empowering and it's powerful if it has been used and applied in the right framework. So I feel if the data is available and in the masses have been taught how to use that data, you know, like the athletes, the coaches, the support staff, They can use it for injury prevention. They can use it for better management of the athlete, creating the right protocols where we can create future champions. At present, the data-driven approach is not there everywhere, but it should begin somewhere, you know, from the grassroots, where the schools or the coaches understand the importance of using one parameter, you know, with numbers in place. And slowly, slowly, you know, it becomes part of their curriculum as well. There should be more coaches workshop about, you know, understanding about sports science and the application of sports science on the biomechanics or the different parameters the athlete goes through, you know, and the importance and implementation of that. Yes, data is can give you, can open many doors when it comes to predicting performance, when it comes to picking the right team, when it comes to injury prevention, and also helping the athlete understand his full potential. For example, if an athlete goes through an assessment and if he needs to check, for example, his if there is a shooter and for shooting you need good amount of static stability control, pelvic stability and balance as well. So that can only be measured because the sport is so fine-tuned in nature. You need those devices to quantify those parameters. And when the athlete is aware of those results, which forms the starting point, he's empowered. He knows that in which direction he's moving. The support staff can precisely fulfill those weaker areas and make sure that he's ready in that component with numbers in place, which directly helps him build up his mental makeup as well.
Thank you very much. That was a very enlightening session. I don't know how much I learned. I can't tell you how much I learned because this is there's so many different and diverse perspectives coming in on this panel. Before, do we have time to open it for questions to the audience? Yeah? Maximum two questions. I see two hands shooting up in the back. There are several hands in front. So I don't know. Yes, the lady here in a striped, blue and white stripes, yeah. Okay, yeah. And maybe then the gentleman at the back, yeah, in the Barcelona jersey, if I can see.
Hi, I'm Anisha Shirolika. I represent Land Sports. My question for Mr. Dayal, you spoke about qualified consent in a player perspective. Now that we are in a pre-data protection legislation phase, and we will soon have a post data protection legislation in 6 months' time. I just wanted to get a perspective, you know, organization perspective, or a federation perspective, or as a collector of data perspective. What are your two bits on what that the organization has to do in terms of? In the scenario that you expressed where the player is, you know, welcome to give an email or, you know, give a forensic evidence of his apprehension of signing off on dotted lines. So just wanted to get your two bits on that.
So my suggestions would be, one is when you frame a data protection consent network framework, you will have to take care of grays as well, and not the blacks and the whites. So the opt-in and opt-out is the traditional format, right? Maybe, and this is, I don't know, I'm speaking from a point of a soothsayer maybe, said maybe that ought to happen, saying maybe you partially opt-in. There's been a huge debate that opt-in should be used more and opt-out and all that. We've been talking about it for 20, since 2000. So that's one. So maybe you should have more categories wherever there's a question of checking something in, maybe. That's one way, as a draftsman, I would say that. Secondly, is about counseling of the athlete. I think the concept of having counseling of the athlete as a kind of an omnibus counselor, somebody who is within the organization but has some autonomy and independence to say that I am going to be the interface between the organization and the athlete and tell the athlete that what are your rights and wrongs, what is happening here, in the language that possibly the athlete understands, in the tone which the athlete understands, not coming from chief executive officer, the middle management. You know, I feel that's, again, it's a personal thought. I have advocated for the fact that why don't federations have counselors for athletes? One institutionalized counselor, when instead the athlete is searching out for a lawyer in the haystack, should go to the federation's counselor who's independent enough to tell him at least the first rung of information.
I see, we can't have foolproof solutions, but at least we can take two steps. And so those are my two suggestions for any organization to implement to get the right responses.
Next question. Yeah, so I am Udyam Mukherjee. I am a practicing advocate. From Mr. Dayal, like you pointed out, that there is a big gap between the practical aspect of how data is collected and what sportsmen actually go through and what we have in the book, etc. Mr. Ranawat highlighted, what he highlighted probably is a more evolved way of taking consent, etc., because these institutes are much newer. But it would be interesting to find out from Tanvie, and my question is for you, because you've had some exposure in English football, would consent, data collection, how would that go about over there? Probably that can give Mr. Dayal an opportunity of bringing about more reforms in the sector.
Well, it was in English. That was helpful. But there wasn't... I was sitting in an office with someone who explained to me before he even handed over to me what I was signing. And then I had enough ample time to sit and read it myself. And if I needed to go back home and take someone else's advice on it, and then come back and sign it. That was the extent of it. It wasn't very extensive. It was just two or three pages. And I completely understood it. I don't know if that will be helpful. I think, for someone who speaks English, I think that was, it was the perfect sort of, perfect draft for me. But the same thing, perhaps, the fact that the person before he even handed me the sheet explained to me what I was signing, where this, what it would mean for
you
even
You acted as the counselor for that lady.
Sorry?
You acted as a counselor for a fellow player, right? That's what you were mentioning. I mean, you explained
Yeah, correct. But he's asking me about when I was in London.
No, I'm just saying, but...
Yes, exactly. If there was a Manipuri player with me there in London as well, of course she would not understand what is even being said to her, forget about what's down on paper. I would make it a point to make sure that if it's not me, someone else can explain to her in her local language, exactly what she's signing, what it means. Means not just legally or anything, but what it means for her future, even within the team, because the team also has its, first team, second team, third team, all that, what her future within the team and things would be. I think that was completely crystal clear to me before the papers were handed over to me, and I had the opportunity to sign it. I was given a good 24 hours just to sit and read it and take someone's opinion.
There's another suggestion which I have been advocating in the athlete space. I'll share it with you. The practicality is that every athlete coming from the hinterland has a friend. There are two people who come to our offices, the athlete and the friend. Why? Because it's the language. They're too scared. They're coming to a lawyer's office in Delhi. They're too scared. They come in, then you ease them out. You talk to them in Hindi. You be easy with them, and then they settle down. Otherwise, they're like, it's a corporate sort of office and stuff like that. So now let's translate that reality into purpose. I'm advocating the concept of institutionalizing Khel Mitra, the friend of the athlete. It's the reality. There's usually an English-speaking, English-translating, slightly less scattered individual, the friend who's slightly more objective than the athlete. The athlete is meant to know his sport. He's not meant to know law. So psychologically, you've got to deal with that reality. So therefore, the friend of the athlete is a very critical factor in our scenario. I can tell you, in 80 to 90% of athletes who come to us from non-urban areas, there is always a very effective intervention by the friend of the athlete. I'm just throwing this idea. I have actually told some friends of athletes to actually institutionalize this idea, and it's in process.
Can I just say that's actually true for me as well? Obviously, because I'm a player, I don't have much legal knowledge. So I'll always have to take a second opinion from a lawyer friend or something so that they can pick up on loopholes that obviously I would overlook. Something that would give the other party more of an advantage over my information than me. So even for someone from an urban background, I think that legal, that legal point of view is important. I get it.
So one thing I think important that we mentioned is the 24 hours that she was given to decide. And I think it is important, it's crucial to have that time rather than give you a paper and sign right then. From my experience, I would want to add to your informed consent query about how it's different in the West. It's not very different in the West. There are athletes I've worked with in other parts of, you know, the global South, where they have investigated, they have been investigated in Europe, in Western Europe, and they have been, you know, asked to sign, and the signing process is something that they often forget to mention when you talk to them, because it's so, you know, it's such a insignificant part of the whole experience. So I think that is important to note, that the fact that informed consent is taken, it remains very insignificant to the athlete a few years later, tells us a lot about the process. One. Number two is often, as which is why I was asking Dr. Ranawat the question about the guardian, is a very important question. When your manager is your guardian, which has happened in certain cases, what are his intentions there? And we don't know. Is it really the athlete's welfare that is foremost in his mind? Is a big question. And these are important part of the process of informed consent, which are often ignored. And it is not only here in a country like India, but it is also ignored in countries like, you know, in Western Europe. Let me not name any.
Just to close, I'm sorry we can't take any more questions, it's just gone on too long. Just to close, I think this session very well explains the thematic idea that the panel was, as in the entire symposium is on, the use of data. Because here you are having people who have used that data, on whom this, who for whom the data has been collected. Now let's go back to the very first discussion we had, where Dr. Sengupta talked about the use of data and specifically mentioned that there have to be sector-specific regulations. My biggest takeaway from this panel is that in this particular sector, despite the fact that we don't yet have those model codes of conduct, etc., which have to be brought into place once the data protection bill becomes an act, my biggest takeaway was, I think we have enough solutions already. We have lesser problems than solutions, because there are people who have been dealing with these issues for years who have come up with curated solutions. We have three ideas coming up from the answer to a single question, which effectively means that there are strategies out there which can be implemented to ensure that there is fairness. And yet, despite maintaining that fairness in sport, the level of intrusion and the level of confidence that a player has on his or her own data and the process of collection and dissemination can be ensured. And I think the future looks bright. I don't know about other sectors, but at least for the sporting sector, it seems that there is enough expertise on board to ensure that the law takes shape in the best possible form and, you know, enables the sport more than disables it. Thank you very much. This was a great session.
May I request Mr. Kiran Vivekananda, Chief Policy Officer of Dream 11, to present our panelists with mementos.
Yeah.